हाय कोयल।
हेलो।
जी गुड इवनिंग, हाउ आर यू? जी गुड
या
इवनिंग,
गुड
गुड आफ्टरनून सर,
इवनिंग।
हाउ आर यू डूइंग?
या आई एम फाइन, थैंक यू। हाउ आर यू?
थैंक यू सो मच, थैंक यू, इट्स गुड टू हैव यू एंड माय बेस्ट विशेस फॉर अ ग्रेट प्रेजेंटेशन इन द इवनिंग। रिया जी गुड इवनिंग, हाउ आर यू?
So great.
सो नाइस ऑफ यू टू बी हियर, थैंक यू वेरी मच।
I was waiting for this event, so I'm so happy to be here also.
ग्रेट ग्रेट, या वी आल्सो, ऑल ऑफ अस आर लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड। दिस अच्छा, आवाज ठीक नहीं आ रही है एक्चुअली। मैं
It's quite low.
या एम आई ऑडिबल नाउ?
हाँ, now it's audible.
ओके ग्रेट, सो दैट इज व्हाट आई वाज सेइंग दैट वी आर आल्सो लॉन्ग ओवर ड्यू एंड सो वी हैव अ बिग बिगिनिंग स्टार्टिंग विद अ बैंग विद कोहली जी। सो अमिताभ, आई थिंक यू मे प्लीज स्टार्ट द प्रोसीडिंग्स नाउ।
We can start now. Good evening, all.
Yeah, I think we.
Shall we start, sir?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Okay. Just people are actually entering, so I think.
Okay, then we'll wait for a. We wait for a couple of minutes and let some more people enter, and then we can.
Yeah, we
okay,
have already
okay.
43
Yeah, nearly
here.
43. Yes, yes.
Are Anand ji also joining? Good evening, Anand sir.
So we'll wait for a couple of minutes.
Sir, I think we can start now.
Okay, so should I start?
Just a minute, ma'am. Actually,
okay.
We have some protocols
yeah,
over there.
Yeah,
okay.
Amitabh, how about we can start, na, please?
We have 60 plus audience at this moment, so I believe we can start now. Okay. Good evening, all.
Yes, Amitabh, please do.
Thank you, sir. Hope you all are staying safe and healthy. Today, actually, we are here to attend a wonderful webinar regarding the cooling tower by our beloved Srimati Koeli ma'am. Myself, Amitabh Dutta, Program and Refrigeration Chair, ISRE Kolkata Chapter. Welcome you all on behalf of ISRE Kolkata Chapter to this webinar. We are privileged to have our RD East, Mr. Anand Trivedi ji. Welcome, Anand sir. We are also privileged that we have our Zonal Women Chair, Riya ji. Welcome, ma'am. We have our Kamal Sarkar sir. He is the Zonal Marketing Membership Development Chair. Welcome, Kamal Sarkar sir. Before starting the program, we have some protocols to start the ISRE videos and all those things. So I request our backend team, Siddharth, kindly share the video, ISRE video. Siddharth, kindly start the ISRE video.
Indian Society of Heating, Refrigerating and Air Conditioning Engineers, ISRE, stand tall in the Indian industry with over 10,000 professionals as members and almost an equal number of student members. Founded in 1981 and headquartered in Delhi, we operate from chapters and sub-chapters spread all over India, bringing our entire industry together. Individuals become members of our society according to their professional and academic standings. Our roadmap of the future looks very bright, with thousands of new members joining this technical society every year and bringing in a fresh outlook to our industry intelligence. ISRE disseminates knowledge through its technical committees, which consists of some of the best minds of our industry. It publishes technical books, newsletters, and a prestigious journal, distributing the wealth of knowledge to all its members. Working with government departments, ISRE helps formalize industry codes and standards. ISRE promotes research by offering financial support to student members to carry out groundbreaking work in technology, systems and processes. Our educational wing, ISRE Institute of Excellence, organizes training programs and workshops to help members enhance their skill sets. Our specially designed certification programs under ICP, that is ISRE Certified Professional, empower professionals to always be in step with the prevailing technology. Specially designed courses for technicians are offered to meet the ever-increasing demand for a skilled workforce. ISRE organizes exhibitions, conferences, panel discussions, and product presentations throughout the country. We organize the industry's largest international exposition in South Asia, Acrex India, to showcase the cutting-edge technology, innovation, and provide a platform for closer interactions amongst the decision-makers in the industry. The Acrex exhibition is now growing from HVAC and R Show into BFA, Build Fair Alliance. This brings together several allied shows connected with the building services industry all at one location. Our chapters organize several other popular events like AcriConf in Delhi, RayCon in Kolkata, Symposia in Mumbai, TechFest in Goa, and many more. We are committed to provide training and career guidance to our student members through seminars, lectures, quiz contests, and site visits. AQuest, a prestigious quiz competition organized by ISHRAE to catalyze the transformation of the budding engineering professionals. ISHRAE provides a platform to potential employers to select student members for careers in HVAC and our industry at the ISHRAE Job Junction. Young minds are made aware of the need for saving power, clean air, and sustainability. The K-12 initiative of ISHRAE focuses attention on school students' development to inculcate a scientific fervor and help develop them into responsible citizens. Speedy information is imperative to keep moving forward in this hyper-connected digital age. Searcho, a specifically designed search engine, is now available, which allows access to a well-catalogued database on HVACR and building services industry with just a few clicks. ISHRAE cooperates with various national and international bodies, industry, governments, academia, think tanks to promote the concept of sustainability, environmental protection, and energy efficiency and conservation. To enter and explore the universe of the Indian HVACR industry, log on to ishrae.in that unfolds a panorama of information. Let us engineer a sustainable future together through ISHRAE.
Now, Lakshya video, as per the our theme of this society year by our national president, Mr. Amitabh Basu. Kindly start the Lakshya video. Great. Thank you, Siddharth. Now, this program, we are very much thankful to our sponsors. We thank to Lloyd Insulations, ALP Aeroflex, Universal and Contromos Group of Companies. Now, it's time for the disclaimer. Siddharth, kindly show the disclaimer PPT. Now, I don't want to waste much more time now. Just to introduce our eminent speaker, Srimati Koeli Samonto, you know, but as per the protocol, we have to introduce her. She is the Deputy General Manager, Marketing for Paharpur Cooling Towers Limited. She is a chemical engineer from Jadavpur University with PGDBM Finance from IIM Calcutta. She has 25 years experience of design, engineering, planning, and business development and sales of HVAC systems. She started her career in MN Dastur and Company Private Limited. After 11 years, she moved to Voltas Limited and next to Sterling Wilson and subsequently joined Paharpur Cooling Towers Limited, where she is currently working. So we are requesting Koeli ma'am to start her presentation. Ma'am, the screen is yours right now. The evening is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for those kind words. And good evening, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, then.
Before starting, I just wanted to interrupt you. To the audience, it is requesting from the East Kolkata chapter that if any queries you have, just put it in the chat box so that after the presentation, we can start one by one and speaker can answer them. Okay. Ma'am, just start. Yes. Thank you.
So good evening, everyone. I'm Koeli Shramantra. I'm from Paharpur Cooling Towers. And today I'm going to talk about the basics of cooling towers. First of all, let us see what a cooling tower is. Now a cooling tower is a device for evaporative cooling of water by direct contact with air. We all know what evaporative cooling means. When water evaporates from a surface, it cools down the surface. So that is evaporative cooling. Now the basic underlying principle for a cooling tower is this. The rate of heat transfer in a cooling tower depends on these factors. Number one is the surface area of water in contact with air. Number two is the relative velocity of air and water during the contact. And the third point is the duration of air-water contact. Now, wet bulb temperature, that is the ambient wet bulb temperature, is the limiting temperature up to which the water can be cooled ideally. That is in absence of any heat load, of course. Of course, we cannot cool the water exactly up to the wet bulb temperature. There will always be a gap when there is heat load. Now, though everyone knows, still I will go through this basic things like dry bulb and wet bulb temperature, what we mean by it, because these are very important when we are talking about cooling tower. A dry bulb temperature is nothing but the ambient air temperature. Now, a wet bulb temperature is the temperature of air when it is measured with a wet wick around the bulb of the thermometer. It measures the amount of moisture that is there in the air. So naturally, wet bulb temperature has to be less than the dry bulb temperature. Now, while designing a cooling tower, there are some basic inputs which are required. First of all is the circulating water flow rate. Second is the hot water temperature at the inlet to the cooling tower. Next is the cold water temperature at the outlet from the cooling tower. Then we have the wet bulb temperature at the inlet of the cooling tower. There are some other factors, though these four are the most important factors. There are other factors which guide the design of a cooling tower. Among them is the availability of space. Now, the area available will definitely limit the size of the cooling tower. And next is the water quality, the quality of the circulating water. This affects the type of fill that can be used. Then we have the application. the application means the, you know, it will determine the plant environment that affects the MOC of various parts. Now we will discuss the effect of, you know, various parameters on the size of the cooling tower. Now, as I told you, the important factors which affects the size of a cooling tower are mainly heat load, approach, range, and wet bulb temperature. Now, a cooling tower size is directly proportional to the heat load. That means as the heat load increases, the cooling tower size will increase. As the heat load decreases, the cooling tower size will decrease. Now, approach, let me just tell you, the approach is the difference between the cold water temperature and the wet bulb temperature. Now, this approach, the cooling tower size is inversely proportional to the approach. That means a longer approach will require a smaller tower, and conversely, a smaller approach means a larger tower. Next is the range. Range meaning the difference between the hot water temperature and the cold water temperature. Now, the cooling tower size varies inversely with the range. Now, we will just, you know, mention here that when I'm talking about one parameter, it means that the other parameters are constant. For example, I'll just go back to the previous slide when I said that cooling tower size increases with heat load. It means that I'm keeping the range, approach, and wet bulb constant. So similarly, when I'm saying that a cooling tower size is inversely proportional to the range, that means I'm keeping heat load, approach, and wet bulb constant. Now that means that if the heat load is constant and the range is increasing, it will mean that the GPM, that is the flow rate, will be decreasing. So a decreasing flow rate and an increasing range means the tower size will decrease. On the other hand, an increasing flow rate and a decreasing range will mean that the tower size will increase. Next, we come to one of the most important parameters, that is wet bulb. That is the ambient wet bulb. So the cooling tower size varies inversely with wet bulb temperature.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you.
Yes.
Can you please reshare your screen?
Oh, there are some not able scratches. To view it.
No, there are some scratches on your screen. That's why.
Okay. I'll just stop share and share again. Okay.
Yeah. Please.
Is it okay now? Hello?
Yes, okay. Yeah, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
It's all right now, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
So we were talking about the effect of cooling tower size. Effect of wet bulb on cooling tower size. So cooling tower size varies inversely with wet bulb temperature. This means that the other three parameters are constant, that is heat load, range, and approach, all three are constant. And as the wet bulb goes down, you know, you're seeing that as the wet bulb goes down from say 80 to 60, the cooling tower size increases. And as the wet bulb goes up, the cooling tower size decreases. Now we will look at the various types of classification of cooling towers. What are the different types of cooling towers? Cooling tower can be classified in various ways, like by way of how an air is moved, Then we have the mechanical draft and the natural draft cooling tower. In a mechanical draft cooling tower, air is moved by means of fans, and in a natural draft cooling tower, air movement is, you know, done without a fan. That is by the density differential that exists between the inside air and the outside air. Now, mechanical draft fan can either be an induced draft and a forced draft. And both these mechanical draft and natural draft fan, they can either be cross flow tower or a counter flow tower. Here we are looking at an induced draft mechanical draft cooling tower. Here we can see that air flows through the tower with the use of a single or a multiple fan, depending upon the design of the tower. Now, in an induced draft cooling tower, fan is located at the exit airstream. This is a photograph of an induced draft cooling tower. This is a forced draft tower. In a forced draft cooling tower, the fan is located in the ambient airstream at the entry to the tower, which is entering the tower. Now, these are photographs, sketches of cross flow and counter flow type cooling towers. In a cross flow cooling tower, as we can see, that air flow and water flow are at 90 degrees to each other. That is why it is called a cross flow type cooling tower. We can see that air is entering from both sides and water is falling from the top in a cross flow cooling tower. In a counter flow cooling tower, air and water flow rate are at 180 degrees to each other. That is why it is called a counter flow cooling tower. These are photographs of a cross flow cooling tower and a counter flow cooling tower. IDCT means induced draft cooling tower. This is a picture of a natural draft cooling tower. As I say, that in a natural draft cooling tower, there is no fan, and air flows through the tower because of the difference in density that exists between the hot air inside and the cold air outside the tower. This is a photograph of a natural NDCT, that is a natural draft cooling tower. These are huge towers, you know, compared to the induced draft cooling towers. These are several times tall. Now we will talk about the basic components of a cooling tower. First is the fan assembly. Now, the fan is an axial flow propeller type of fan. This is a gear reducer. And this is a drive shaft. Now, this is one of the most important component in a cooling tower, which is the fill. A fill can basically be of two types, splash type fill and film type fill. Now, film type fill, which we are seeing at the bottom, it provides superior thermal performance because it has a higher surface area per cubic meter or cubic feet of fill. But it has certain water quality parameters required to operate optimally. Like TSS, that is the total suspended solid, it has to be less than 100 ppm. Then oil and grease has to be less than 5 ppm. Airborne dust has to be minimal. And the circulating water has to be treated for, you know, control of biological growth like algae and others. And there should not be any scaling. A splash type fill, which we are seeing at the top, on the other hand, it gives a a lesser thermal performance because it has a lower surface area per cubic meter of fill, but it has no specific water quality requirement. I mean, TSS can be unlimited, and oil and grease can go up to, you know, even 500 ppm. And air quality requirement is also not that stringent. And water treatment can be moderate. So wherever we are in doubt that the air quality and water quality is not up to the mark, there splash tank fill is used. Next is the drift eliminator. Now, a drift eliminator is used for removal of entrained water from the discharge airstream. Next is the louvers. This louver material that is the at the air entry. This can be of various MOC. That can be FRP, it can be SCB, it can be PVC, it can be even RCC. Next is the cooling tower structural material. We have timber cooling tower. We have pultruded FRP cooling tower, and we have HDG steel cooling tower as well. Casing materials include ACB, FRP, and RCC. This is the fan cylinder. Fan cylinder can be either made of plywood or FRP or RCC. Now, very often people ask us, what is the difference between a cross flow and counter flow cooling tower, and how can they be compared? So we have prepared some few points by which we can compare a cross flow and a counter flow tower. Now, the most important part of a cross flow tower is that the condition of fill media can be inspected even during tower operation. And in case of counter flow tower, the tower has to be shut down in order to inspect the fill. Now, the fill in case of cross flow can be inspected either from inside or from outside the tower, but that is not the case for counter flow. It can be only seen from inside the tower. Now, cross flow in cross flow tower, access to fill is so easy that, you know, it is very, very easy to replace a part of fill with a minimum effort. But in a counter flow tower, access is a little more difficult, and it requires more effort and resources to replace even a part of a fill. For cross flow tower, inspection of water distribution is very easy because there are no pipes. In a counter flow tower, on the other hand, you know, again, the cell has to be shut down, and then the entire distribution piping has to be checked. So it is a difficult task. So from point of view of maintenance, cross flow cooling tower is always preferred. Again, these points show that fill and nozzles are easily maintainable. If there's a, you know, damage of fill or some nozzles are choked, it can be easily seen and maintained. And counter flow tower, it is difficult to maintain it. Cross flow tower footprint of splash type ITCT will be smaller. Footprint of same capacity splash type IDCT will be larger for counter flow. Again, you know, film fill cross flow IDCTs are built for smaller capacities. Again, you know, film fill is not really recommended for a dusty environment. And for counter flow tower film fill will be smallest in size, and for a capital expenditure, it will be low for a given capacity when compared to other types. But there are limitations of water quality, then air quality, maintainability. So that we will have to see which one outweighs the other. Some other important parameters when we are talking about cooling towers is the cycles of concentration. Now, when the water evaporates from the cooling tower, the salt concentration in the remaining water increases. The COC is the cycle of concentration, that is how many times the TDS in the cooling tower water is multiplied by the TDS in the makeup water. So the COC has to be maintained to control the TDS level, because increased TDS means high level of scaling, which is not at all desirable. So to avoid this, what we do is blowdown, periodic blowdown. Another important factor is drift loss. Drift loss is, you know, some fine water droplets escape along with the exit airstream. That is the drift loss. That is also to be minimized. So a general guideline when we are, you know, designing the cooling tower and when we are trying to ascertain the operation of the cooling tower is that the actual circulating water flow rate should be as close to the design flow rate as possible. And range should also be close to the design range. Fan power consumption should be close to the design fan power. Everything, you know, including makeup water quality, should be close to the design. Makeup water supply and blowdown should be continuous as possible. If we maintain this, you know, the lot of problems that are faced can be avoided. For continuous, consistent performance of a cooling tower, because a cooling tower is designed to operate for years together, but for that, a proper maintenance of its component is essential, especially proper maintenance of fill along with the distribution system, proper maintenance of fan and associated other rotating components. These have to be maintained and checked periodically. So whenever there is a complaint of poor performance, it has to be checked whether the condition of the fill, condition of the fan, you know, everything which is as per the design as it should be. There are some common myths, we call it, which I thought we would show. The first one is that people often say that my cooling tower is operating with lower range instead of the higher design range. They say that cooling tower performance is not good because the range is not as per the design. The fact is that the range, which is the difference between the hot water temperature and the cold water temperature, it is not decided by the cooling tower. It is decided by the source of hot water. So a cooling tower decides only the approach. It does not decide the range. Number two is that counterflow cooling towers are more efficient than cross-flow cooling towers. We have often heard people say that. That is not true. The fact is, both cross-flow and counterflow cooling towers will have same efficiency for a given capacity. Then number three, sometimes we hear that wooden towers are not at all environment friendly because they're cutting down trees. But the truth is that if the policy is right, the timber can be cultivated in abundance. And you know, this timber which is cut, it can be regrown in 30 years. Because timber is the only material where economy and ecology goes hand in hand. I mean, in other types of cooling towers, when we are talking about FRP or steel, you know, in the manufacturing process, it is not always a green process. Number four, we hear that FRP hollow blade fans consume less power. Now, that is not the case. I would just like to mention here, of course, everyone knows that fan power is equal to air flow rate and total pressure. So whether a fan is hollow or solid, you know, the type of blade has really no significance in determining the fan power consumption. So that's all we have come to the end of basics of cooling tower. I hope it was useful to everyone. If you have any question, please ask.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am. It's a wonderful session. And we have a few questions over there in the chat box. So I would request audience to unmute yourself and ask the question to our speaker. First, I request Mr. Niladri Mukherjee. He has some question. Mr. Mukherjee, kindly unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Mr. Mukherjee.
See, very interesting that when we discuss about the cooling tower, along with the cooling tower, another is coming, that is the air cooler. Both are almost the principle is same. But what I, you know, we are in academic line also, we find that most of the people don't know actually what is the difference between evaporating cooling and normal cooling, which is done by the radiations. So anyhow, when I get the opportunity, I explain that everybody should understand, whenever you are using the airflow here, the surface of the water, which having a molecule, that is the physics, the molecule of the water actually start increasing. So the kinematic energy which is developed, it generally takes heat from the lower level and it gets evaporated. So the lower level of the water is gets cooled. That is a process. When we ask an interview in many areas, even in I find that your powerful cooling tower also, many people came for interview, they were not very clear about the actual evaporating process. So I'm in this platform, I'm clearing the physics of this matter. When you are increasing the air flow, surface of the air molecules start increasing, and the kinematic force which generates heat, it takes heat from the lower part of the water. So water getting cooled, that is a process. So I get an opportunity in explaining you, because we are into different design and consulting also. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So I think you have cleared the your query. Now we have another question from our Mr. Sudip Nath. Sudip Da, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, Kohli, just I want to know, the you have shown that force draft cooling tower, the fan is at the bottom. So which are the application area, means where it is used? Normally, conventionally, it is not seen.
Yes, force draft is not used usually, you know, almost in all applications. Induced draft cooling towers are used. Force draft is, you know, use is very less. Almost all applications you see, you know, induced draft will be suitable.
Sudip, this is Praveen Sen.
Yeah, tell me.
Actually, I have seen only one force draft cooling tower in my whole life. That was in a cinema hall, and that was in 1969, a cinema hall in Durgapur. They were using force draft cooling tower, and there was absolutely no reason. Actually, somebody sold them a force draft, and that time people were making force draft, and that's why they were using it. But there is no reason why one should go for force draft.
Yeah, that is I'm asking, that the academic interest, that may be a...
Fan and gearbox, they are out of the moist air area. That is the advantage, but that's not in nowadays. 56 enclosures are available, so there is no reason why we should go for a force draft cooling tower.
Excuse me, I'm Anand Trivedi from Ranchi. Can I add to this?
Yes, please, Anandji, please. Most welcome.
With regard to force draft, actually, there are certain applications which demand using a force draft cooling tower. For example, in a steel plant, there is an application where this slag is basically impurity. When we produce iron, this slag floats and it comes at the top of iron, molten iron, and that slag is being wiped off first, and then we take out iron and process it separately. For using this slag again, we have to granulate it, means we have to granulated by using spray water. So we impinge a jet of water in this molten slag so that this water gets this slag gets granulated, and then the slurry, that means this water and slag, they are separately then dewatered. Now this water, because it impinges directly to molten slag, it gets very hot, and in the circulation it reaches to a temperature of 80-85 degrees centigrade. So to reuse it, many times there is an application where we need to cool it back to 40 or 45 degrees centigrade, and there are certain slag particles which are erosive in nature. They remain there in the water, and since the temperature is very high, so if you want to cool it in a conventional induced draft cooling tower, then use of fills first thing is very difficult, and again that high quantity of moisture, it affects badly your fan blade health as well as the health of your gearbox. So there you find this application. Forced draft fans are forced draft application is there, so that this thing is taken out of the circuit of actually moist air. So your life of gearbox, fan, and these things can be retained. Thank you.
Thank you, Anand sir. I'd just like to request everyone to mute yourselves, please. Your voice is coming on and disturbing others. So it's an earnest request, everyone, kindly mute yourself, please.
I'll just like to add, you know, you were talking about steel plant. Steel plant, you know, there are various applications. Of course, the special application which you talked right now will be different, but in other applications in high temperature areas as well, induced draft cooling towers are used without any problem.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, this is an application where we are having erosive particles. These slag particles are very erosive in nature, and no fills can withstand this for a longer period. So it's basically a kind of spray from the top, and the height of the tower is high, and then this air flow is basically from the bottom. So it's a kind of forced draft without fill. Fill less, forced draft cooling tower.
Okay.
So another question from Mr. Rakesh V. Mr. Rakesh, please unmute yourself and ask your question. Mr. Rakesh, are you there? Maybe Mr. Rakesh has disconnected. So I just repeat his question. Ma'am, your slide says blowdown should be continuous, but any lead projects are not allowing blowdown as huge quantity of water is drained. Wooden tower lead to fungus formation. And another point he has added, metal blade will add the weight, thus it will consume more power. So Kweli ma'am, can you explain this or?
Yes, I will just address this one by one. Number one is the point of blowdown. Now it's a very delicate balance, that whether blowdown will be less or more. It depends on the availability of water. Where there is a lot of scarcity of water, definitely you will not be allowed to do much blowdown. And if you don't do periodic, continuous blowdown, your COC will increase, then scaling will increase. So that call has to be taken, that decision has to be taken, but it is necessary to limit the TDS level in water. And next point, what was the next point?
Wooden tower lead to fungus formation.
Fungus formation. Now, wooden towers, as I told you, the water has to be treated. There are various types of water treatment processes available. So this water treatment for removal of algae, it has to be done. There are biocides components, chlorine containing components. There are various compounds which are used for treatment of algae and treatment of scaling. So these has to be used to avoid the formation of fungus. Otherwise, it can be a problem anywhere. It is not that if I use wooden tower, there will be fungus. So because with the proper maintenance, there should not be any fungus if the water is treated properly. And the next point, I think, was about the fan weight, you know, lighter weight. So I would just like to explain that a fan is an air moving device, and the fan, it is designed to move the air. The power that is consumed by the fan is for moving the air mainly. I mean, more than 95% of the power consumed by the fan is for air movement. It is not for moving itself. You know, for moving itself, that is the its blades, it will consume a slight, maybe 1 or 2% of the total power will be for moving itself, but the majority of the power consumption will be for movement of air. So whether it is lightweight or, you know, it is heavyweight, whether it is hollow or whether it is solid, it will affect the total power consumption to such a small extent that it is really not worth doing it. That is all we can say. We can go into detailed calculation, but I think that can be done separately. And you can check yourself that how much will the actual, you know, actual reduction in power consumption will be if you change the weight of fan. That is why we say that the MOC of the fan, whether it is aluminium or FRP or in FRP, whether it is solid or hollow, will not affect the power consumption of the fan.
Normally, these are the tube axial type fans, no? So aluminium aerofoil blades are there, basically.
Yes, yes. Okay,
another question. Next question from Mr. Chinmoy De. How do we can calculate the efficiency of a cooling tower?
How to increase the efficiency of a cooling tower?
How do we can calculate the efficiency of a cooling tower?
Oh, the detailed calculation that I can share separately, you know, the efficiency calculation. I don't think
this is a long process, I believe.
This is a long process. I can talk to you in detail about this separately. If you can send me.
Almost same kind of question again by Mr. Sujoy De. What is the selection criteria for number of cells in a cooling tower? Now, that is different. Okay. Number of cells in a cooling tower. What is the selection criteria?
Number of cells, you know, that will depend on the application and what is the total flow rate, what is the you know, the operating condition. Excuse me. I think somebody
yes, kindly unmute yourself, please.
Yeah, there was a disturbance in between. Please carry on.
Ma'am, please carry on.
So this number of cells that will depend on the, I know, various design criteria, like the total water flow rate, as well as what is the optimum water flow rate. There are sometimes, you know, some operating flow rate, and sometimes, you know, people keep some standby also. So it all depends on how much standby you want to keep, whether it is 25% standby, whether it is 30% standby, whether out of, you know, out of the total capacity.
So, Rana, start on tau to bole dilo.
Yes, out of, yeah.
Kindly mute yourself, please.
Yes, so it all depends on what is the operating capacity and what is the, flexibility in operation that the customer wants. So that is how we will select. You know, we can go for 2 working 1 standby, we can go for 3 working 1 standby, we can even go for 1 working 1 standby, or sometimes, you know, all the cells are working. It all depends on application, into application. So depending on the application, it is chosen, and it is affected by the area available also. So everything, it is not a unique criteria that we just close our eyes and, you know, do it. So it will vary from application to application.
Okay. So next question is from Mr. Bipin Pahuja. He is asking that natural draft cooling tower, which application or when it is preferred?
Yes, natural draft cooling tower, you will mainly see in power plants. where the you know the amount of heat load, the amount of water flow rate is huge, and you know the area available is also not a problem, and you know the power consumption, the continuous power consumption becomes so high that it has to be eliminated because power is costly. In a power plant, we would like to, you know, reduce the power consumption as much as possible. So in that case, well, it is so huge. You know, if you move the so much amount of air by a fan, it you know, it becomes so costly that in such cases, you will go for a natural draft cooling tower. So that is the reason we will see that in large applications, in very, very large applications like power plants, usually people go for natural draft cooling towers.
Okay. Mr. Vipin, hope you're you got your answer, right? The next question is from Mr. Rakesh Jungare. If difference between DBT and less WBT is very less, then cooling tower is useful.
Actually, it's useful or not, just have to ask.
I didn't quite get the question. You are asking the range is very small. I mean, or what?
DBT and WBT is very less.
WBT, okay. The dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature. Wet bulb is very close to the dry bulb. That is what you're saying. It is a very dry wet bulb. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, that is when there is too much moisture in the air. That is your question.
High humidity areas, ma'am. High humidity.
High humid area. If the gap is less, definitely evaporation will be less because cooling tower operates on the principles of evaporation. So we need a driving force. We need the difference. So if the difference is less, you know, so it will be difficult to evaporate and it will be not that useful.
How expansion tank is selected? The same person has another question.
Hello? Yes? Yes?
How expansion tank is selected?
I'd like to interrupt here. Expansion tank, I'm sorry, this is Manish Tiwari. But expansion tank, this is a cooling tower line, condenser line, I presume is an open circuit line.
Yes.
So there is no requirement of expansion tanks here. It is required only in closed hydronic loops. So in chill water lines, you will have an expansion tank, but in this system, your expansion tank
you don't
is not
require this. Yeah.
No. I hope I've been able to correctly answer this, Samantha.
Yes. Thank you.
Solution that is a suspended solid tension tower. Acha. Another question from Mr. Abhijit Sarkar. Which kind of field splash, field or film, is better for maintenance?
It's for maintenance. I mean, if you want to go for maintenance free operation, then definitely splash type field will be better. Because it can withstand quite a lot of deposit, and in any dusty environment, in any high ppm environment, it can operate. So for less maintenance, and it is easy to clean also. So that in that way, splash type fill will be easy.
Another question from the same person: whether size of cooling tower increase for splash fill since it is less efficient compared to the film fill?
Yes, you are right. For the same tower, if we want to replace the film fill with splash fill, then the tower height will increase. The entire size will increase because of its inefficiency.
Okay. Now, another question from our young guy, young CWC team member, youth co-chair, Mr. Sauram Guho. He is asking that due to space constraint from all or two sides, is it advisable to use forced draft instead of induced draft?
No, no. I mean, forced draft or induced draft, that decision is not taken because of space constraint. As I think it has been explained before at the beginning of the question and answer session.
Ma'am, if I may ask once, is it a myth? Like, because in many sites, what they say is that if there is a closed building near to the tower, a wall is coming up. And it is blocking the, you know, the induced draft, they suck in air from all four sides, right? Uh-huh. So if there is a hamper, blockage to the air that is being sucked in, does it affect the efficiency? And is it advisable to go for forced draft, or is that a myth?
Yes, of course, your air entry, there has to be room for play. The air entry cannot be obstructed. You have to choose a site where the air entry can happen without any obstruction. A sufficient gap has to be maintained between the nearest obstacle and the air entry to the tower. But that is not a reason to, choose a forced draft tower. You can choose an induced draft tower also with some modification. If you, give me the exact application, I can tell you how to choose it and how to, place the tower in that in that area also. Okay. Among all the constraints, that can be done.
Okay. Another question is from Mr. Subhra Shankar Chaudhary. Can we minimize the water bleeding out from the cooling tower, and how?
Hello. Yes. Minimizing the blowdown.
Yeah.
Yes, that you have to treat the water properly. Water treatment plant has to be installed so that the PPM level, the TDS, everything is as per the recommended criteria of a cooling tower. So if it is well below the accepted level, definitely your salt deposition with time will be less, and there will be less need to blow down water. So that can be minimized with proper treatment of water.
Okay.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Last question from Mr. Subho Saha. How performance of cooling tower is affected when approach tends to zero? Does it mean heat release rate is less when approach tends to zero?
No, approach tends to zero means no one has been able to design a cooling tower where approach tends to zero. We have been able to design a Pahadpur cooling tower with a 1 degree Celsius approach. That is the best we have been able to do.
Ready hoye geche.
Proper...
No, ma'am.
Yes, sir. So, 1 degree itself is a very, very tough tough situation. It is a challenging task. So usually you will find that 3 to 4 degrees Celsius, that is the approach at which cooling tower works well. Cooling tower works easily, selection of the tower is easy, but as the approach decreases, tower size increases significantly because everything has to be changed. The fill, the fan, everything has to take care of the increased load. So it is a different selection process than the normal cooling tower selection.
Koeli, this is Pratik here. With your kind permission, can I just add to what you said?
Yes, of course, Pratik. Yes.
Okay. You see, theoretically, if you can manufacture a cooling tower with a 0 degree approach, but your sizes of the cooling tower will be infinity.
Infinite. Okay. I mean, we are not talking about infinite towers.
Right. So it is not practically possible. Now, your question could be that practically and commercially, how much close we can go? I think possibly you meant that when you asked this question.
Yes, of course. Commercially, right. It has now, to be viable commercially.
Yeah. As per CTI, Cooling Technologies Institute, there is a limit of 5 degree Fahrenheit approach. So no cooling tower manufacturer is liable to exhibit or prove its performance beyond or below an approach of 5 degrees Fahrenheit. So that is a conscious call which is taken across the spectrum, that nobody will ask a cooling tower manufacturer to prove its performance below a approach of 5 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's as per CTI standard.
So 5 degrees Fahrenheit, as I was saying, that that is the standard approach that all right. will give you. But yes, if you want to improve the performance of your chiller, I'm talking about HVAC system especially. If you want to decrease the power consumption of your chiller, you will go for a lesser approach. In order to do that, the cooling tower has to be designed with a lower approach. That is the reason it was designed, actually. And it is performing, and definitely CTI may not ask you to prove your performance, but it can be shown. Performance can be shown.
Thank you, Pratigda. Thank you, ma'am. Another question is there from Mr. Judhaji Chakravarti. He is asking, if variable speed pumping is in condenser side, how does this affect performance of part loads?
Now, variable speed, you're talking about the pump. The cooling tower can take part load, it can take care of 100% and 5%, to 50%. There is a limit between which a cooling tower operates. Each and every selection, it is designed for a certain range in which it can operate. So depending on the selected cooling tower, we'll be able to tell you, between which flow rate it can operate.
This is the last question we have from Mr. Suresh Sringari. One of our projects has noise sensitivity expected dB below 45 at 3 meter. So what is your advice on sound attenuator for inlet and outlet?
Sound attenuators can be provided in the cooling tower. But definitely that will affect, that will increase the loss. So definitely cooling tower performance will be affected. Now, there are other ways of, controlling sound other than putting sound attenuators inside a cooling tower, maybe in the fan chamber. I don't know what exactly was this current scenario, but the noise control can be done by putting sound attenuators in other places also, like some louvers or like some sound dampening walls or something else which will not be inside the cooling tower and which will not affect the performance. Otherwise you can select a fan with a low RPM. You can select, a gearbox can be selected with a, lower ratio. That can be done. There are ways, but usually sound attenuation is done externally.
Okay. Ma'am, Mr. Anand Trivedi, our regional director, has some questions. I would request Mr. Trivedi to unmute yourself and ask the question directly to ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Actually, ma'am, this is with regard to hybrid cooling towers. People are claiming that they are using very less water, means the combination of heat exchanger as well as cooling tower. The upper part is consisting of probably heat exchanger, and the lower part, we are having that cooling tower application. So what's your experience?
So I really don't have any, I have not used any hybrid cooling tower. I will not be able to comment on that. Yes, I have also heard that people are using it, but then I'll have to collect information on that. If you want any specific answer, I will collect any available information on that and I will get back to you.
Sure. Please, ma'am. Because probably where water crisis is there, people are using that kind of technology, I suppose. So if you have any information, kindly share with me.
Yes, for areas where water scarcity is there, you can try adiabatic coolers. You know, that is the latest product we have in Paharpur. So adiabatic coolers are designed for areas with acute water shortage, severe water shortage. So if you want, we can have a separate session altogether on adiabatic coolers.
Sure. Maybe we can have a separate session on that and yes. We'll see. Okay, ma'am.
So with this time to vote up thanks, right? So I would request our chapter president, Mr. Manish Tiwari, to give the vote of thanks. But before that, we have our national treasurer with us today. We are very privileged. So, Utpal sir, can you say something to this evening and presentation?
Yeah, no, I would not say something only. I'm very pleased to see that Koeli is there and getting involved with our Kolkata chapter. That's a great part of it. So, I know that how Women Chair will be working on this place. I have also seen that a lot of attendees are also there. I've seen that Deepa Madam is there, National Chairwoman. I've seen also Anand Trivedi, RD East is also there. Deepakda has joined. Shenda has joined. PK Shen, Prabhi Shenda joined. Pratik Rai always joins from his, Bangalore. I have seen also Sudip Nath, our CWC member, also join. It's a great, experience with you, Koeli, in this evening with this lecture. And I would like to say thank you very much for getting involved on this ISHRE program. And I'm sure Kolkata chapter and the nationally ISHRE headquarters will also get a lot of benefit through you also. Thank you, Kolkata chapter. I have seen that almost 116 attendees were there. That's quite large number as far as the, it's quite good. Thanks to the, team who has organized, Manish, Amitabho, Nilanjana, Shubham, and everybody. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Utpalda. It's always a pleasure hearing from you. So nice of you to attended this program. And coming back to our program, I am really thankful to Ms. Koeli Samanto. It was really a crisp and informative presentation. And
thank you, all of you.
And the proof of the pudding lies in eating it. So we had about 116 people and all very attentive and with such questionnaires coming in from industry stalwarts like Pratik Da and Sudip Narji and all these people, Mr. Anand Trivedi sir. So everything it was, this is what we at Kolkata chapter are looking in when we conduct programs. Because programs need to be informative and they need to be interactive. And this session especially, we are very happy because this was the first women's session of ours. And it was both, and I'm so delighted to have Ms. Koeli Samanto be with us today. And a special thanks to Ms. Deepa Raj Ganesh, our national chair, women's, who was also present in this presentation. I'm sure that she would have enjoyed as much as we did over here, organizing the show. Same with Mr. Anand Trivedi and Mrs. Ria Kasliwal, the zonal chair, women's. So I think we are all proud that we have, it's not a special thing about women's chapter. It was a program which was actually very well done. And for that, I would like to thank the team which went forward to organize this with our president-elect, another lady, a very smart one, Nilanjana Mukherjee, the program chair Amitabh Dutta, our Mr. Shoram, who is the co-chair of the youth, and the back-end team with Siddharth Mazumdar, and also special thanks to Mr. Suvam Banik, who has always been as a youth zonal chair, helping Kolkata deliver such good questionnaires to us. Finally, I would like to say that there were a lot of questions. Most of them were very rightly answered by the speaker. And definitely there were some follow-up things which I'm sure would have to wait for another day when we could have Ms. Samantha again with ourselves to carry this good work forward. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for being here. And so till next time, take care, goodbye, and be healthy. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Okay, stay safe.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everybody. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Approach to the sponsor.
Yeah, Amitabh, I think we can close the program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.